Hello, everybody.
Hi.
The title of tonight's lecture, Staging the Easter Rising, 1916 is Theatre, is the title of a publication by James Moran. Make sure I get the right button. Lecture in Drama and Performance at University of Nottingham. And tonight's lecture is based almost entirely, not quite, but nearly entirely on James Moran's book. Moran sets out to examine theatrical representations of the Rising within particular historical contexts. His aim is to discover the continuing impact of the Easter Rebellion on Ireland and the Irish. You might well ask why he selects theatrical representations as his chosen medium on a topic as complex and multi-layered as the Easter Rising. Possibly because playwrights speak directly to their constituency. And he sees this theatrical immediacy as a good way of investigating issues. The shared response generated between performers and audience brings the playwright's text to life. His message becomes a living reality for the duration of play, depending, of course, on the talent and expertise of the actors and the production team. This gives plays a distinct advantage over other forms of media. Or maybe he's impressed by the history of the playhouse as the stamping ground of revolutions and as a vital aid to insurgency. Do we have recorded instance of this explosive power? We surely do. In 1601, the Earl of Essex's attempted coup against Queen Elizabeth began with a special performance of Shakespeare's Richard II. In which play, King Richard is challenged by Bolingbroke. The King, Richard, loses support, abdicates, and Bolingbroke is crowned Henry IV. A well-chosen script on the part of Essex, and proof of his belief in the power of theatre. But he still ended up executed for treason, even though he was Elizabeth's favourite all his life. Moving on to 1872, in Istanbul, Nami Kamal's drama about the Crimean War, entitled Fatherland, brought swarming crowds onto the streets calling for holy war. For this we're indebted to Misha Glenny in the Balkans 1804 to 1999, Nationalism, War and Great Powers. Going back to 1830, in France, a company rehearsing Rossini's William Tell found the cry, and forgive the French pronunciation, found the cry of "Où la dépendance, où la mort," so stirring that they rushed out into the street and joined the troop that toppled Charles X. In the same year, according to Anthony R. Blaster's Viva la Libertà, Politics in Opera, an audience in Brussels rushed from the theatre showing Auber's La Muette Cortisi. Oh, that's William Tell. And I failed to find an image of poor Auber, but anyway, that's his poster for La Muette Cortisi. Following the performance, or during the performance, they stormed to the courthouse and began the national revolution that established Belgian political independence. So beware, the theatre is a powerful force. But before getting down to looking at the two playwrights I've selected, I'd like to take a look at the theatrical qualities of the actual Rising itself. When the Easter Rising began, some bystanders believed they were witnessing the opening of a play. One such person happened to meander into Liberty Hall on the eve of the rebellion, as the rebels were busily shifting grenades and ammunition. Seeing Constance Markowitz, whom he knew to be a member of the Theatre of Ireland, and being in Liberty Hall, where dramatic productions were staged every Sunday night, he stopped her and observed. Rehearsing, I presume? Yes. Is it for children? He asked.
No, said Markins.
This one is for grown-ups. That snippet is taken from Terrible Beauty, A Life of Constance Markowitz by Diana Norman. Christopher Morash, in his History of Irish Theatre, gives us an account of Joseph Holloway's blunder on Easter Monday. If we could find Holloway, there's his self-portrait. Holloway was an inveterate theatre-goer and famous diarist of first nights at the Abbey. He noticed a hoarding displaying the proclamation of the Irish Republic. He noted the Gaelic heading, the floridly worded sentiments, and assumed he was looking at an announcement for the Theatre of Ireland. When he read it through, he found that an assortment of playwrights and producers had endorsed the document. He saw the names of Tomás McDonagh, a writer whose productions had graced several Dublin stages, Joseph Plunkett, who worked with McDonagh to establish the little experimental Hardwick Street Theatre in 1914, James Connolly, whose play had been performed at Liberty Hall the previous month, and Paul Pierce, whose plays Holloway had attended both at St. Edmund's School and in the Abbey Theatre. He understandably concluded he was looking at a theatre announcement rather than a revolutionary manifesto. If he had seen a more extensive list of the rebellion's participants, his conviction that it was a theatrical event would have been reinforced. The Abbey Theatre's usherette, Nellie Bushell, who you see first from the left, the theatre's stagehand, Cather Carney, and its prompter, Barney Murphy, whom you see at work, complete with his script and his glasses, all members of front of house and backstage at the Abbey, they all joined the rebels, as did many of the actors. Maureen Foodley. Oh, are we going back or forwards? There she is. Maureen Foodley, looking quite resplendent in her Jack B. Yeats portrait. Helena Maloney, with due apologies to Helena, that was the best photographer I could find. Arthur Shields and the now famous Sean Connolly. Connolly was a young actor who appeared regularly at the Abbey and was the first Irishman to die in the rebellion. His final stage appearance prior to the rebellion was in the part of MacMahon in James Connolly's play, Under Which Flag. Said role involved him in carrying a tricolour on stage and encouraging the Irish to give their lives for their country. According to Peter DeRossa in his book, Rebels, the Irish Rising of 1916, while young Sean Connolly was attempting to unfurl a tricolour in the rebellion, he was shot by an English sniper. Mirror up to nation comes to mind as a particularly apt definition of theatre. But not only bystanders saw the theatricality of the event. In Coogan's biography of Michael Collins, we hear Collins declare, looking at it from the inside, it had the air of a Greek tragedy about it. This image was no doubt bolstered by many of the leaders wearing kilts and by Pierce carrying swords that were highly symbolic, although of little practical use against British machine guns and shells. Also, the rebels chose to fight in buildings such as the GPO that were hopelessly exposed to enemy assault on three sides. But provided the ensuing carnage with an unforgettable backdrop. Dubliners can hardly be blamed for presuming that the stage world was spilling out onto the streets of their city. It's been well well documented that the Easter Rising was opposed by almost everybody in Ireland at the time. According to Yeats, in his uncollected prose, the leaders knew they had to shake the populace as if it were an audience in the theatre in order to attract popular support. That notion may sound less than credible, but if we look at Ben Levitas's account of the programme at the Hardwick Street Theatre in the run-up to the rebellion, it might lend some credence. During the preparations for 1916, Macdonagh and Plunkett's Hardwick Street Theatre provided a forum for strategic debate about the military tactics of the Irish Volunteers. Some of their productions supported Owen McNeill's idea that the Volunteers should refrain from hostilities until they were attacked, or until conscription turned public opinion in favour of revolutionary activity. But other plays performed in Hardwick Street emphasised the success of the insurrectionary who acts without necessarily waiting for public validation. In fairness, a secret society like the IRB could hardly conduct an explicit public debate about their rebellion. And so, the Playhouse provided an alternative meeting place for ideological and tactical discussions. But we must leave the theatricality of the rebellion itself and move on to how both O'Casey and Yeats represented it on stage in later years. There they go, famous pair. Yeats and O'Casey are often considered to have held completely divergent views about the Easter Rising. Declan Kyburd, in his tome, Inventing Ireland, directly contrasts Yeats' poem Easter 1916 with O'Casey's play The Clown and the Stars. Quote, "While Yeats lists the names of the warrior dead, O'Casey worries about the nameless civilian casualties. Where Yeats salutes the heroism of the rebels, while of course questioning its necessity, O'Casey goes further and questions the whole idea of a hero," which, of course, is why his play The Clown and the Stars caused such notorious riots in the Abbey Theatre in 1926. It's commonly asserted that Yeats' play The Dreaming of the Bones is pro-1916, while O'Casey's Clown and the Stars is anti-1916. But that oversimplification somewhat misses the point. The issue is not so much whether they were for or against the Rising, but whether they were for or against what the Rising had come to signify at the time they were writing their plays, or at the time their plays were performed. 1926 for O'Casey and 31 for Yeats, 10 and 15 years after the Rising. We've had 100 years to contemplate and cogitate, and we're still adjusting our responses. The rawness of Dublin audiences in 1926 must have been palpable. They'd survived the Rising, the War of Independence, the signing of the treaty, the Civil War. And in the aftermath of all that, O'Casey's Clown and Stars goes on stage. Picture the families of the executed rebels sitting in their national theatre, watching O'Casey portray their dead heroes as flawed human beings, albeit in a piece of dramatic writing which is hailed as a masterpiece. In fairness to O'Casey, we must look at how his perception of events brought him to that depth of anger and disillusionment, particularly since he was an avid Republican. In his early 20s, he joined Gaelic League and learned the Irish language. A natural progression from this was membership of the IRB and the GAA. The ideology of all of the above would be anathema to the unionist views of his family. He did, however, maintain his involvement with the church and worked hard to persuade Protestants to join the national movement. Eventually, his religious fervor began to wane. In its place, he adopted a new creed and hero in the shape of Jim Larkin and his Irish Transport and General Workers Union. O'Casey believed that the nationalist movement needed to be allied to the political philosophy of the labour movement. This idea was not popular either with the Gaelic League or the IRB. O'Casey resigned from both and was critical of what he termed their middle-class nationalism. He then turned his attention to the Irish Citizen Army for a time, but internal politics caused him to resign from that also. The final nail in his coffin, so to speak, was the change of leadership from Larkin to Connolly. This led to his dedication to the labour movement beginning to wane. He saw it as losing its socialist focus. O'Casey was a convinced socialist. He felt that reviving the Irish language and removing British rule must be welded to the philosophy of the labour movement. Rather than being content with an Irish republic, he insisted on an Irish workers' republic. He was filled with consternation by the IRB's failure to support the workers' strike in 1913, which was cruelly crushed by the police. O'Casey's sympathy was at all times focused on the crime of poverty and failed to see value in political freedom, which did not also encompass economic freedom. Even though he had distanced himself from the IRB and the Citizen Army, he retained his allegiance to the revolutionaries following the rising. In 1919, he articulated his pro-national sentiments in the story of Thomas Ashe, describing the 1916 insurgents as those who, because of the hope that was in them, fought with the glow of enthusiasm and light in their hearts. But at some point, between 19 and 26, O'Casey decided to lambaste the rising. In the Plough of the Stars, maybe we should look at not only how O'Casey abandoned the rising in the years following 1916, but how the rising turned away from him. After the rebellion, O'Casey believed that the masses should be prompted into action by firm guidance from men and women of intellect and influence. He hoped that a slender and able group might continue to direct the force unleashed by the East Rebellion in the service of socialist revolution, regardless of what the bulk of the population actually thought at the time. But these hopes were dashed at the end of the Civil War. By 1926, it was clear to O'Casey that the Easter Rebellion was no longer owned and organized by a secretive cell of far-sighted revolutionary thinkers, but by the bourgeois Democrats who sat in the door. The national movement and the workers' movement had parted company. It was time to give vent to his dismay, disillusionment, disappointment, etc. in the Plough of the Stars, a play which strove to be a theatrical event rather than just simply a play. He aimed to assault popular pieties and to shock the audience members out of their complacency. He succeeded on all counts. I have to leave time and space for Yeats' play, The Dreaming of the Bones, so I must leave O'Casey. But not before I give you at least a resume of the plot and characters and some comment on my favourite moments of this powerful and oh so funny play. O'Casey is the king of tragic comedy. He hits you with a heart-rending moment and counterbalances it with bawdy comedy, or rowdy comedy, rather than bawdy. It's clear that O'Casey enjoys his characters and he wishes his audience to enjoy them also. Even when when he's in a serious mood, he's more likely to be satiric than solemn, to be poignant rather than pathetic. Truth plot. He sets the play mainly in the tenement apartment of Jack and Nora Clitheroe. They're in the early years of their marriage. Nora's pregnant with their first child. Jack's a member of the Citizen Army and is promoted to officer early in the play. Nora protests strongly against his involvement. She's O'Casey's mouthpiece. O'Casey found the idea of Irish mothers willingly sending their children out to be massacred for Kathleen Houlihan to be repugnant. Nora is written to be the antithesis of Margaret Pierce. Margaret Pierce wrote in 1919 to the head of the San Francisco Gaelic League, "I have only done what every Irish mother should do willingly as I did, give their beloved ones for Ireland and for freedom." End quote. Not only did O'Casey mock the mother of Pierce, he mocked Pierce himself. In Act Two, an unnamed orator addresses a meeting offstage. We only see him as a silhouette in the pub window. So he's totally peripheral to the actual action of the time, which is in the pub. The fragments of oratory that he speaks were originally written by Pierce. It's easy to see why the audience write it. Jack Clitheroe is the representative of the now executed heroes. He ignores his wife's protests, leaves his real woman for the mythical Kathleen Houlihan. And we have a scene here where you can actually, that scene is played. That's Jack and Nora at the door. She's hanging on to him. He's come by, as per O'Casey's version of the rebellion. He's come by the area where she lives. His comrade has a wounded comrade he's trying to carry. And Nora runs out to hang on to Jack and beg him to not continue with the rising, but to stay home. He prises her off his body and he leaves. So naturally, while he's away at the rebellion, Nora goes into labor. Her baby is stillborn and her husband is killed in battle. Nora loses her reason. The other tragic characters are Bessie Burgess and Little Malzer, who dies of consumption. Bessie is killed when she tries to drag Nora away from the window at the height of the rebellion, as the now demented Nora screams for Jack to come home. Bessie despises the rising. Her son is away at the front. Hers is the only unionist voice in the play. And of course, since it's an O'Casey play, Bessie is taken for a sniper at the window as she tried to save Nora, and is shot by an English bullet. I hear you say, how in the name of all that's reasonable can that be a funny play? Remember, it's tragic comedy. The comedy is carried by the two characters who live with Jack and Nora. Nora's uncle Peter and her cousin Cody, all in a two-room apartment. The tenement neighbors, Luther Good, Jeannie Gogan, Bessie Burgess, are also coming. And of course, not forgetting the famous prostitute, Rosie Redmond, who appears in the bar scene. Interestingly, when the nationalist rioters were given a public meeting to voice their objections to the play, they ignored the anti-hero scene and the very cruel attack on Margaret Pierce and her son, and concentrated on the presence of a Dublin prostitute on stage, claiming that there were no prostitutes in Dublin. In spite of the fact that the lane behind the Abbey Theatre was a well-established prostitute beat. And the actor who played Rosie in that first production, Rhea Mooney, that's Rhea in the previous one there, that's Rhea with Sean O'Casey, that's the young, that's the age he was, as he was in 1926. When Rhea was preparing her performance as the prostitute, she based her character on what she was able to observe on her way to and from the theatre. Back to the characters. The Gogan family, headed by Ginny, has been decimated by TB, or consumption as it was called then. Ginny lost her husband to TB and is about to lose her daughter, Monser, also. O'Casey uses this family as his seal cameo of tenement squalor and hopelessness. Not surprisingly, he gives Mulzer the line which synthesizes the entire narrative. She delivers it as she sits outside the squalid tenement in a ray of weak sunshine in the company of Nora, Thither, who has brought her out a mug of milk. The chaos of the rising is deafening, as is the hilarity of the tenement dwellers who are running in and out the door with their loot from the shops, mainly consisting of goods totally irrelevant to their needs. Mulzer observes to Nora, "Is there anyone gone, Mrs. Tilbury, but a tittle of it?" There you have it. O'Casey's hard-hitting play in the public meeting which followed the riots marked the end of his ambitions to be a Dublin playwright. Like his contemporary Joyce, quote, he would not serve. On the 5th of March 1926, he too became an exile. The Abbey was berated in Dublin newspapers in 1926 for having staged the plough. But in 1931, when Ireland celebrated the 15th anniversary of the Easter Rising, the Abbey again premiered a play about the Rising. And this time, the theatre's managers decided to perform Yeats' play, The Dreaming of the Bones, in order to challenge popular perceptions of the rebellion, just as they had done 5 years before. Yeats' play echoes some of the most subversive aspects of the plough, and like O'Casey, Yeats wanted the first performance of his play to demolish what he considered to be sentimental and mawkish nationalism. Yeats had every reason to suspect that The Dreaming of the Bones might again provoke disquiet among the Abbey audiences. And when the play was being prepared for performance, he was so excited that he mistakenly dashed back from Coon Park to Dublin for the rehearsals, a week before the rehearsals were due to begin. Yeats did consider his play to be, quote, too powerfully political, as he stated in a letter to Lady Gregory at the time of writing, 1917. But academics who have considered The Dreaming of the Bones at great length have devoted the vast majority of their energy to exploring its aesthetic relation to Japanese no drama, rather than its political significance. Yeats' political message was no doubt subsumed by the externals of the no tradition. The Abbey audience of 1931 were presented with an unfamiliar spiritualist dance drama. And we have a little image, there you go. The dramatist persona reads, three musicians, their faces made up to resemble masks. A young man, a stranger wearing a mask, a young girl wearing a mask. The only direction on costuming simply reads, of a past time. Yeats himself describes his no plays as follows. I have invented a form of drama, distinguished, indirect, and symbolic, and having no need of mob or press to pay its way. An aristocratic form. End quote. Yeats was moving away from the more overt political engagement of a play such as his Countess Catherine or his Catherine Mulan, and away from the wider audience on which the Abbey was increasingly dependent. In his note introducing The Dreaming of the Bones in Four Plays for Dancers, he states, the conception of the play is derived from the worldwide belief that the dead dream back for a certain time through the more personal thoughts and deeds of life. End quote. This explanation must have been puzzling for many readers at the time. But Yeats states it as if it is glaringly obvious, a worldwide belief. The idea that Irish folklore and legendary material was part of a worldwide system had been with Yeats since at least the 1890s. Not surprising then that he cast his no-inflected play about 1916 with characters from Irish folk legend. spectral characters in the play Diarmuid and Derbhla are real historical figures. However, when we tease out the differences between what's known about this pair and their roles in Yeats' play, it becomes clear that he's interested in something other than history. The historical Diarmuid MacMurrough was, in fact, King of Leinster, but Yeats sets his play in West Clare. MacMurrough is reputed to have kidnapped his rival king's wife, Derbhla O'Rourke, though some sources suggest she was complicit in the kidnapping. In any case, she was not young at the time she was carried off, nor was Diarmuid. When he invited soldiers of the English King Henry II into Ireland to help him defeat O'Rourke, the historical Diarmuid was in his 50s. Yet the spirits of both these characters who inhabit the dreaming of the bones are young lovers, as would be the popular folk perception of them. So Yeats is working here not with history, but with a popular memory of Diarmuid and Derbhla as young lovers who defied a king and betrayed a kingdom for their love. That's how the audience remembers them, and it is with remembrance as such that Yeats is concerned. In a sense, collective memory is the play's raw material, shaped by the lower form, which is said to be a storehouse of history. Yeats' aim was to produce a work that is about death, and the way in which the past, even the recent past, can inhabit the present as living remembrance. And so, to the plot of this one-act play. A young Easter Week insurgent from the GPO is fleeing the British reprisals when he meets a mysterious man and woman who tell him a ghostly but smutty tale of two accursed spirits. These spirits, because of their adultery, must wander alone for eternity, perpetually longing for the forbidden touch of one another. Yeats rather learns that the phantoms, quote, once lay warm the livelong night in one another's arms, committing a passionate sin, unquote. Although the young rebel is initially bemused that the ghost's adultery resulted in such a pitiless punishment, his attitude hardens when he realizes he's hearing about Diarmuid and Derbhla, the 12th century adulterers, widely remembered for fighting their enemies by inviting the Anglo-Normans to intervene in Ireland. When it transpires that the rebels' companions are themselves the spirits of Diarmuid and Derbhla, the rebel finds he's unable to pronounce his forgiveness upon them, and so condemns them to exist in an ongoing state of purgatorial longing, where they can reflect on the profound and disabling changes consequent on their original adultery, the Elizabethan plantations, the Cromwellian campaign, etc., etc. The adulterers now bear the additional responsibility for the occupation of Ireland by British troops in the 20th century. And the rebel has had to try to annihilate their legacy by taking part in the rising. Yet, in the middle of the play, the rebel almost gives in to the terrible temptation to forgive the ghosts. He suffers considerable torment about whether to pardon them, encouraging Yeats' audience to realize that it's not only the British troops that the GPO who belong to the disastrous legacy of Diarmuid and Derbhla's fornication. The occupation of Ireland by the Anglo-Normans permanently affected almost the entire Irish race, including the rebel's own lineage. Yeats' ghost fathered the revolutionary. The rebel is one of the consequences of their transgression and cannot forgive the authors of the evil which he fights and curses. Yeats' appearance on stage at the final curtain of The Dreaming of the Bones was met with polite applause. Isn't it amazing how articulate an audience can be in its response? Polite applause. What's the message? Are they bewildered? Bored? Unknowing? Higgins may have liked to throw on the suitability of poetic drama to a theatre audience. He describes it as drama for the delight of a few, sufficiently learned or imaginative, to enjoy the absence of scenery and facial expression. In poetic drama, one avoids the realistic intrusion of the actor, who under a mask becomes an impersonal, abstract symbol. His voice is intensified by the employment of complex music or by drum taps. And between speeches, the tension of silence is likewise intensified by the controlled movements of a sympathetic dancer. The entire starkness of these productions was too great for an untrained public, says F.R. Higgins. In fairness to Yeats, he never intended his four plays for dancers as material for stage. He intended them to be only performed in the intimacy of the drawing room. His need to air his political message on the 15th anniversary of the Rising obviously overcame his original intention. Yeats' message about the sacrificial mother is akin to that portrayed of the plough. His young rebel despises the parental figures who brought tragedy and slavery to his country and have helped to destroy Celtic Ireland. This notion of motherhood is very far removed from the sacrificial mother of such writers as Daniel Corkery, Maurice Dalton, Margaret Pierce, etc. Yeats also invoked Padraig Pearse's writings, just as O'Casey did in The Plough and the Stars. When Yeats scripted the lines, quote, "Blood has returned to the fields that had grown red from drinking blood of mine," end quote. He was using the same source O'Casey had used for his unknown orator in the pub scene. It's quite amazing that these two playwrights from vastly different backgrounds should have almost identical reactions to the aftermath of the Rising. They both had wanted an elite group of intellectuals to govern. They were both appalled by the political reality of the very new state. They could not accommodate themselves to the way the Easter Rising, in their view, had been appropriated by those in government. In 1916, the rebels were scorned by churchmen and journalists alike for their doomed attempt at rebellion against the might of the British Army. Yet, by 1926, collective memory was recording a very different story. Maybe I should run the risk of disturbing both Yeats and O'Casey in their graves by concluding with, or giving my concluding line to Pierce. The fools, they left us our Fenian dead. Thank you.